Halo anak-anak, video kali ini akan menampilkan soal-soal Primary School Leaving Examination atau PSLE untuk Primary 6 Singapore. Soal-soal ujian PSLE terkenal sulit. Jadi kalau kalian mengalami kesulitan dalam mengerjakan soal-soal, jangan berkecil hati, tetap semangat. Yang penting berusaha sebaik-baiknya. Bagi anak-anak yang sekolahnya berbahasa Indonesia, perlu banyak latihan soal supaya terbiasa dengan istilah-istilah matematika yang dipergunakan. Untuk contoh-contoh soal tipe open-ended question, bisa dicari di internet ya. Sekedar mengingatkan, penilaian seleksi ASEAN Scholarship menyeluruh, tidak hanya berdasarkan soal-soal matematika. Jadi, kerjakan tiap tes sebaik-baiknya. Tetap semangat walaupun mungkin tes matematikanya terasa sulit. Selamat menyaksikan.
Hello everyone, today we'll be going through five questions from PSLE. So these questions will actually be kind of difficult. So feel free to pause and take your time understanding the questions. We'll be starting off with question one, which is about distance and speed. So according to the question, we have a bakery and a library which are 120 meters apart, labeled here in the graph, 120 meters, and they are located between Hong's house and Jia's house. And the bakery is exactly halfway between the two houses. So the distance between here to here is the same as the distance from here to Chi. And one day, Hong and Jia started cycling from their houses at the same time, and they arrived at the library together. So they arrived here together. Jia cycled at 70 meters per minute, while Hong cycled 15 meters faster, 15 meters per minute faster. So this is quite easy to calculate. The speed would just be 70 plus 15, which is 85 meters per minute. And the question wants you to find how much further did Hong cycle than Jia. So obviously they arrived at the library at the same time and Hong cycled faster. So Hong cycled a longer distance. And to do this question, we have to use our imagination a bit. Suppose that Hong cycled at 70 meters per minute instead of 85. So suppose that Hong cycled at the same speed as Jia. That means at the time when Jia arrived at the library, Hong would have reached a point somewhere here, which these two distances would actually be equal to one another because they traveled the same at the same amount of time and at the same speed. So from here to here is the same distance as from here to here. Now that also means that since the bakery is exactly at the halfway point, these two distances must be equal to one another. So let's call this point P. Then the distance here should be 120 meters as well. And this is the case if Hong traveled at the same speed as Jia, but Hong actually traveled 15 meters per minute faster than Jia. So at the time Jia reached the library, Hong traveled an extra amount, which is just from this point P to the library. And this is quite easy to calculate. It's just 120 meters times two. So the answer to this is 240 meters. And for part B, how far is Jia's house from the library? To calculate this, we first need to find out the amount of time it took for Jia to reach the library. And how we do this is we use the answer from part A, 240 meters. Now we know that the extra distance Hong traveled here is actually at the speed of 15 meters per minute. Because if he had traveled 70 meters per minute, he would have only covered this amount of distance. But he traveled 15 meters per minute faster. So he covered the 240 meters at a speed of 15 meters per minute. So to get the time, it would just be 240 divided by 15, which is actually 16 minutes, I believe. Okay, so now that we have the time, which is 16 minutes, now we need to be able to calculate the distance. And we already know the speed, Jia's speed. So from the formula, the distance would just be equals to speed times the time. So speed times time, which is just 70 meters per minute, multiplied by 16 minutes. So this should give you 1,120 if I calculate correctly. And yeah, that's question one. For question two, this is a question on grouping, where we have Jessie, who requires 200 pieces of ribbon to decorate her room, and each of these ribbons must be 110 centimeters long. If the local store only sells ribbons of 25 meters, so 25 meters is just the same as 2,500 centimeters, what is the minimum number of rolls that Jessie needs to purchase? So how many of these 25 meter rolls must be purchased so that we can have 200 pieces of ribbon? So to do this, we first need to find out how many pieces of ribbons can we make out of one roll. So one roll is 2,500 centimeters, and I'm just going to write down first, one roll is 2,500 centimeters, and one piece of ribbon, one piece, is 110 centimeters. So how many pieces are in one roll? All we need to do is divide 2,500 by 110, and we're going to get 22 remainder 80, I believe. 22 remainder 80. Oh, sorry, no, not 8. Wait, yes, 80. And that means we will have 22 pieces of ribbons, as well as 80 centimeters of the roll left over. But if we think about it, we won't be able to do anything with this 80 centimeters left. So let's say if we have a roll of ribbon here and we cut off this amount, the piece left here, we can't really combine it with anything else because it's just a short piece of ribbon. So we actually just need to throw away this 80 and we need to focus on this 22, the number 22 here. So I'm just going to write down one roll is equals to 22 pieces. And we need 200 pieces. So how many rolls is in 200 piece? So to get that, we just need to do 200 divided by 22. And that's equals to 9 remainder 2. Yeah, so we will have 9 rolls, can give you 198 pieces of ribbon, but we'll have two pieces of ribbons left over that we have not gotten yet. So if we bought 9 rolls, we would only have 198 pieces, but we need 200. So what we need to do is we need to actually buy one more roll to get 220 piece, and that satisfies the 200 pieces ribbon. So the minimum number of rolls is 10 rolls. Question 3 is a bit similar to question 1, where it's also about distance and speed, but the context is a bit different. So in here we have Faisal and Elise who started jogging from the same spot. So they both started here and they went forward at a constant speed, which we don't know yet. But what we do know is that Faisal was 30 meters per minute faster than Elise. And so that means that Faisal reached the end earlier than Elise. And what the question said was that after he reached the end, he made a U-turn. So his route was like this, and then he went a U-turn. And this is the meeting point between Faisal and Elise. So that's Faisal's route, and Elise's route is here. So the amount of time it took for Faisal to go all the way like this is the same amount of time as Elise going to this point right here. Okay. So the question wants to know what was Elise's speed. Now, to do this question, just like the previous question, we need to know actually what's the extra distance that Faisal traveled compared to Elise. And if you think about it, Elise never actually ran this part right here. And Faisal ran this part right here twice. He went this way 600 meters, and he also went this way 600 meters. That means the extra distance that Faisal ran was the extra distance was actually 600 plus 600, which is just 1,200 meters. And we also know that Faisal was 30 meters per minute faster. And that means we can actually just find the amount of time it took for the run by dividing this number with the speed. So because this is the distance and the speed it took him to complete this extra distance is 30 meters per minute. Because if Faisal ran the same speed, Faisal would have just reached the same point Elise did. So the time, total time, is just 1,200 divided by 30, which gives you 40 minutes. And now that we have the time, now we can find out Elise's speed because we also know the distance between Elise's start and Elise's end. So we know the distance is 4,000 meters. So the speed is the distance divided by time, and that's equals to 4,000 divided by 40, which gives you 100 meters per minute. For question four, we're going to use a method called branching. So this is a fraction question. Pupils in school are put into two groups. So I'm just going to, we have a school here, and we're going to split it into two groups, group A and group B. And we know that 2/5 of the pupils are in group A. So this is 2/5. And this is, should be 3/5, because if one whole is the whole school, and 2/5 is group A, that means the rest are in group B, which is, so this 3/5 comes from 1 - 2/5. And we also know that 1/4 of the pupils in group A are girls. So I'm gonna split this into girls and boys. Girls and boys. I'm going to just make it small letter to make it less confusing. Girls and boys. And we know that 1/4 of them are girls. So that means the fraction of the whole school that are in group A and are girls, we actually just need to multiply these two numbers. So if we calculate it, it's going to be 2/5 times 1/4, which gives you 1/10. So 1/10 of the school population are girls in group A. And in the school, 3/10 of the pupils are girls. Okay, so if we do the same split here, according to question, 3/10 of the pupils are girls. That means if we add up these two numbers here, it should add up to 3/10. Okay, so we know that 1/10 plus something is equals to 3/10. So 1/10 plus something is equals to 3/10. And since these two denominators are the same, we can actually, is this question is the same as asking what is 1 plus what is equals to 3. And that's just, the answer is just 2. So this is just 2/10. And 2/10 is the same as 1/5. So it's the same as 1/5. So the number here should be 1/5. So what we need to find is the fraction between B and G. So in the previous step, how we got this 1/10 is we find the product between 2/5 times 1/4, and that gives us 1/10. So the same thing actually happens in here. We do 3/5 times something becomes 1/5. And notice that 1/5 is actually just 3/5 divided by 3, because if we do 3/5 divided by 3, then obviously this 3 becomes a 1, and we're left with 1/5. So we already learned that in order to convert from division to multiplication, we want to flip the fraction upside down. So this is 3/1. Flipping it upside down becomes 1/3. So the answer here is actually 1/3. And that's the final answer. 1/3 of the pupils in group B are girls. For the last question, we can solve it using ratios. And according to question, a bookshelf can fit either 30 big books or 45 small books. So let's focus on this first sentence first. So then the ratio between the number of big books the shelf can fit compared to the number of small books is 30 to 45. So this is big, the number of big to the number of small that the shelf can fit. That means if we simplify this, it becomes 2 to 3. Now, this ratio can tell us that the amount of space that two big books take is the same as the same amount of space as three small books. So we can always replace two big books with three small books. Okay, so this is a very, very useful information to solve the next part. And in the next part, we have there are 3 big books and 23 small books on the bookshelf. And what is the maximum number of big books that can be added onto the bookshelf? So if we have 23 small books on a bookshelf, let's ignore this three big books first, and focus on these 23 small books. So if we only put small books on the bookshelf, and we already put 23 small books there, that means we're left with 22 small books of space to fill in. And we know here that two big books is the same amount of space as three small books. Now this can also mean the other way around, where three small books takes this same amount of space as two big books. So this also means that 21 small books would be the same as 14 big books, because from here to here we multiply by 7, and from here to here we multiply by 7 as well. So this relationship is very important, and if we have 22 small books, then that's the same as having 14 big books and one small book. So this is the same as 14 big books plus one small. Okay, so now we can go back to the question here, where we have 23 small books and three big books. So if we want to fill the bookshelf completely, we're going to have 14 big books plus one small and 23 small books, because this is the same as 22 small books. So since we already have three in the shelf right now, that means the amount of big books we can add onto the bookshelf is 11, from 14 minus 3, which is 11 big books. And the reason it's 11 and not 12 is because this one small book remaining here, it's too small to replace for a big book, so we can just ignore it.